Thank you for attending the Curry Research Lectureship Series, the last one of the fall semester. My name is Anne Partee, and I am a fourth-year doctoral student in the Educational Psychology Applied Developmental Science program here at Curry. Today's talk is sponsored by VEST, which is the Virginia Education Sciences Training Program. Since 2004, VEST has been supported by the Institute of Education Sciences at the U.S. Department of Education. VEST prepares students to apply theory and methods from the social sciences to research on schools and classrooms. Program faculty and students strive to improve equity and evidence in education. Today, we are delighted to welcome our own Dr. Veronica Katz from the University of Virginia. Veronica's research interests center on understanding factors that can improve teacher quality, and in particular, what can be done to keep the best teachers in the schools that need them the most. Today, she will share her research on the effect of performance-based financial incentives on teachers' decisions to stay and teach in high-poverty schools. I should also mention that I had the opportunity to work with Veronica on a project early on in my graduate training, and I so appreciated her willingness to answer all of my very basic statistics and data cleaning questions, of which there were many, and also helped me out in other ways along the way. So thank you, Veronica, and I still use the Stata code that you sent me years ago. Veronica will be talking for approximately 1 hour and will leave 15 to 30 minutes for discussion and questions. Please note that any additional or personalized questions after 12:30 can be addressed via email, as other meetings will be beginning at that time. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Veronica Katz.
Well, thank you all for being here. It's really nice to get to share this work with you. I want to start with a bunch of acknowledgments. In the fine print, there are funders, obviously, who've made this work possible through IES. There's also the District of Columbia Public Schools and many, many people there who we've collaborated with over years who were just great about answering questions, sharing data. Without that, this work would not happen. Also, I'm going to embarrass Jim for making those partnerships possible and supporting this work in many, many ways. And also Emily, who is now a co-author on this paper and who's helped me really add new years of data and think about it in different ways. So thank you. All right, so this work, this effect of performance-based financial incentives on teacher employment decisions is motivated by a pretty well-established literature at this point. We know from lots of research that teacher quality varies. So you have some teachers who are really effective, some teachers who are not so effective. And we know that that variation in their performance matters for students. Students who are paired with a more effective teacher have really different outcomes in their lives. So it's not just about their test performance. They are less likely to become pregnant as teens. They are more likely to go to college, have higher income. So really what we're talking about when teacher quality is about changing outcomes for students. What we know less about is how to improve teacher quality, especially in low income and low performing schools. Conceptually, if we think about sort of a distribution of teacher effectiveness, we've got our low performing teachers over here, our really, really star performers over here, and then a bunch of teachers in the middle, we can kind of think maybe about three big mechanisms to try to improve this distribution of effectiveness. One is what we would call changing the composition of the teacher workforce, and this consists largely of retaining fewer of your low performing teachers, less of the teachers from this bottom end of the distribution, and replacing them with higher performing teachers. Another thing you might try to do is retain more of your high performing teachers. So the ones that you know are the most effective, what can you do to really try to keep more of them? And that's where the work I'm presenting today is situated. And a third really important but challenging mechanism would be to really try to shift the entire distribution of teacher effectiveness through support, teacher development, professional development, what we might call. We are doing some work in that area, and that is really, really hard. There's not much, as far as I know, that tells us, like, here is a professional development program or a set of supports that you can offer to teachers that's dramatically going to help all of the teachers get better. or even just the ones from the middle, making them into the super high performing teachers. I should pause and say, if there are clarifying questions, please interrupt me. Those are my ground rules. So if something I'm saying doesn't make sense, let me know. Okay. So as Anne said, what this talk is about is how to keep the best teachers in the schools that need them the most. And I understand that there are some very loaded terms here, in particular this idea of what do you mean by best teachers and what do you mean by schools that need them the most. And fortunately, in the District of Columbia Public Schools, or DCPS, where this work is situated, there's a system to identify both of those things. They have a way to identify their quote-unquote schools that need the teachers the most, and a way to identify their quote-unquote best teachers. So we've got about 120 schools in DCPS. 30 of them are high-income schools. They're not being identified on this map, but this is just a little map of the distribution of schools in the city. The remaining schools are all low-income schools, but those get split into two buckets. You've got 50 low-income schools, and a subset that are 40 low-performing, low-income schools. And I think it's important to stress here that this designation is not one that we have come up with as researchers. This is something that DCPS identified. They said, here is a list you can find online. These are our 40 lowest-performing schools, and we are making a very intentional and public commitment to try to change the outcomes for the students in these 40 schools. We could look at a number of statistics and to illustrate the fact that these schools are really different. So demographically, high-income schools are about a third white, a third black, and the remaining Hispanic and other race. If you look at the low-income schools, they're more predominantly black and Hispanic, and then in those targeted 40 schools, they're almost entirely black student population. And these sort of trends, these differences, are marked across pretty much every type of demographic that you could cut. Visually, if we're looking at the share of students who are scoring proficient or advanced, this is math, the chart looks almost exactly the same. In reading, the top line here, at about 80% of students scoring proficient or advanced in math, are for the high-income schools. At about 40% proficient or advanced are the low-income schools, and then, no surprise, your lowest performing low-income schools are down here with about 20% of students scoring proficient or advanced in math. I am not sharing this to depress anybody. I'm just trying to make the point that these are really different contexts, and arguably that these are the schools that need the teachers the most. So then we come to this idea of what do we mean by, yeah, yes, Beth.
I'm just curious, is DCPS defining low performing as just the level, like the proficiency levels, or are they incorporating some measure of growth in how they're thinking about performance?
So they made this decision in 2012, and I think I don't think it was a growth thing. I think it was just like, these are the schools that continually are at the bottom of the performance distribution each year. When they made that designation, those 40 schools, they were like, even if those schools get better, they are going to remain as a targeted 40 school for the duration of this policy period. So it's like a 5-year designation. Yeah. Thanks, sorry. Okay, so turning to this idea of how DCPS is identifying their best teachers. There are about 3,500 teachers in DCPS, and bless you, since 2010, all of these teachers were evaluated as part of IMPACT. So IMPACT is their teacher evaluation system. It is what's called a multiple measure teacher evaluation system. They use classroom observations. They do use student achievement data for the teachers who teach in tested grades and subjects. They also have some other components that measure teachers' commitment to the school community. And there are also teacher set goals for their students. So all of these components get put together to assign teachers an overall rating. And there are these strict cut points. If your overall impact score, so that's, there's sort of all this weighting of those different components that gets put together to give you a score of 100 to 400 points. At the top end of the scale, they identify their highly effective teachers, their best teachers. These are teachers who are eligible for really large financial incentives, so that's kind of going to be a big focus of the work I'm doing now. Effective teachers are, they're doing good, they're not highly effective, but importantly, they're not in these bottom categories, and teachers who are graded developing, minimally effective, or ineffective face some pretty serious consequences for their performance. Teachers who are ineffective are dismissed. Teachers who are minimally effective or developing are placed on what's called a salary hold, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment, but it's basically like normally teachers progress on this very standard payment scheme. They don't get that normal increase in their pay. And eventually, if they fail to become effective, they are also dismissed. The financial incentives are two types. For each highly effective rating a teacher receives, they get an annual bonus of up to $25,000. And in addition to that, if you are twice highly effective, you get what's called a permanent salary increase of up to $27,000 per year. And let me tell you a little bit more about what these permanent salary increases, how they work, because I think it's important to understand really what this means. It reminds me, maybe because I'm a mom, of the game of chutes and ladders. Normally, you get to just kind of like, you spin a little spinner and you move along one spot. But if you're lucky and you hit a ladder, you get bumped up. And that's basically what happens with these permanent salary increases. I had to take it and reformat it, but this is an actual screenshot, essentially, of DC's salary scale. It's truncated. It normally would keep going off here into additional steps. But essentially, a teacher enters with a certain level of education, let's say they have a bachelor's degree, and after in their first year, they're earning $53,601. In their next year, under normal circumstances, you would just move up to step two. So just like this. After your second year of teaching, you move to step three. And this is where sort of like the chutes and ladders effects comes in. Under impact, if you are twice highly effective, you get both education credits and years of experience credits. So you get bumped like this. Instead of moving from step two to step three, you move up to the master's band, and you're being paid as if you had 8 years of experience. And it's permanent. So you stay on that step, and now you continue to move forward from there. So that's why that permanent salary increase has a huge present discounted value, or it's a really large incentive.
Can you get that more than once?
Yeah, so if you're twice highly effective again, you do it again, and that time you would get bumped up to the PhD level and more experience. Yeah, good question. All right.
So, in your analogy, is there a chute then? Like,
unfortunately, no. There is no chute. Once you move up, you don't move back. It's a great question. And same thing, like, nothing gets taken away from you. So, if you were highly effective and then you are no longer highly effective, you just keep moving along. If you're highly effective and you're ineffective, you are dismissed. Like if that were to happen to you. So it's just based on your rating in that year. Yeah. Yes. So it's really ladders and ladders. All right. In 2015-16, just to give you a sense of the distribution of these ratings, 36% of teachers in DC were eligible for one or both of those types of financial incentives. A large portion of teachers are still falling into this effective band. 16% of teachers were minimally effective, developing, 5% were minimally effective, and the remaining 2% were ineffective. So just to stress the point that impact, unlike maybe some other teacher evaluation systems out there, is actually distinguishing teacher performance levels. Everybody is not getting a highly effective rating. A lot of people are, but still some people are falling into these lower performing buckets where there are consequences. The other thing here is that this distribution is not the same across schools. So here I'm showing you the percent of teachers who were highly effective by their school's poverty status.
In low poverty schools, by the end of our period of analysis, more than half of the teachers in, high income schools were highly effective. Whereas about a third were rated highly effective in the low income schools, and close to a quarter were highly effective in those targeted 40 or low performing low income schools. So it's still, I think, the point I'm just trying to drive home here is that we've got this distribution of both student performance and student outcomes. We, I think, have a clear sense of the schools that, quote unquote, need their best teachers, and we have a sense of where those, who those best teachers are, at least as defined by DC. Okay. Our analysis is going to leverage a whole set of reforms that were implemented in 2012-13. So the time period starts here in 2010, which is the first year of impact. It's also the first year that DC apparently collected any data on their teachers. So if you can't go back before impact in this world. We've got our 120 schools split up in the same way, 30 that are high income, 50 low income, and 40 of these targeted 40 schools. And what changes really are the financial incentives. Sorry, I couldn't think of a nicer way to display this, but I will try to be clear. In high-income schools, what happens is that your bonus, if you're once highly effective, you now can only get a bonus of $3,000, and you no longer get to play the chutes and ladders game. That's gone for you. You don't get that permanent salary increase if you're twice highly effective at a high-income school. In low-income schools, your bonus is reduced slightly. So now for each highly effective rating, the maximum bonus you can get is $15,000 instead of $25,000. But you have the opportunity to get a larger permanent salary increase. So now if you're twice highly effective at a low income school, you can potentially get bumped up to that PhD band, which is the highest paying band. And then they give you 5 years of additional experience. And finally, the largest incentives were reserved for the teachers in those low-performing, low-income schools. So that $25,000 bonus is now only available in targeted 40 schools. For each highly effective rating you get, that's where you can get that largest bonus. And it's the same salary increase that's offered to the highly effective teachers in the low-income schools. Well,
This actually may be more toward your graph from a couple slides ago around sort of the distribution of highly effective teachers. How, I mean, should I be thinking of that as it's more difficult to be a highly effective teacher in a sort of low performing 40 schools? Or should I be thinking of teacher quality as just sort of the distribution is off, in other words?
Yeah.
Should I be thinking about how's DCPS thinking about that?
It's a great question, and it's exactly a question that Emily and I were talking about yesterday. I don't know how DCPS is thinking about it. I think, yes, it is harder to be highly effective in a low-income and low-poverty school. And actually, that's specifically why DCPS says we're going to give the biggest incentives to the teachers in those schools. So these are quotes that I took from what their impact guidebooks, it's like the literature they distribute to their teachers about like, here's how impact looks this year. And what they say is like, why do teachers in schools with high free and reduced price lunch rates, so those low-income schools, receive a higher bonus? And they say, we are trying to help our highest poverty schools attract and retain outstanding educators. This is why we are offering higher bonuses to the individuals who serve in these schools. And then in those targeted 40 schools, I think they say, we felt it was appropriate to recognize the most effective educators in these schools with higher bonuses, given the additional challenges they face. So I think like they're saying, like, this is a challenging environment. It is hard to teach here. It is hard to be highly effective here. Therefore, if you can do it, we want to recognize you and reward you for it. And one way they're going to do that are through these bonuses. Does that answer your question a bit?
That's really helpful.
Okay.
Yeah. Ron, could I follow up on that? So, It sort of speaks to two issues, right? One, just to pick on the observation protocol for a moment, whether a teacher teaching exactly the same way in those two environments would get rated lower given the context in which she's teaching, right? That's one version of this, that the measure itself doesn't recognize the challenge.
Right.
The other is that the teachers themselves are different in those two places, right? That it may be that really effective teachers recognize that it might be more challenging there, and they sort themselves into the higher income schools. Do you have any sense? I mean, those are two quite different versions of both of which are covered by what DC says here, right?
Yeah.
Do you have any sense of that distinction?
Empirically, no. I don't think I do have a great, I can't like pull apart those two mechanisms. I mean, I think, I don't want to like defend, I don't want to come across as like trying to defend DC's evaluation system, but I think especially in this period of analysis, they did a lot of things to try to safeguard against some of that, having a different review because of the context that you're in. And so one thing that comes to mind, as you know, are they had these master educators. They had these observers going in to observe teachers who are not specific to the school. So it was like, if I was a master educator, I could be observing teachers in many different kinds of schools. And so I think that's one way to try to say, like, I'm observing teaching in all these different contexts and trying to not be influenced by the context and just observe the actual instruction that's happening. But I don't know about the sorting side of it. I mean, I think teachers do sort intentionally.
So to follow up on that, is the judgment of is effectiveness, the score for effectiveness, based entirely on the views of these observers?
No.
Of the classroom teacher?
It's not. It's it depends on what subject you teach, but basically it's about 50% of your score is the classroom observation, so the person who comes in and observes you. If you have no test score data, so if you teach kindergarten and there's no test score to evaluate you with, it is 75% of your overall effectiveness.
The test score is also a part of it?
If you have test scores, yes. So if you have test scores.
Scores are a part of it.
Yes.
And again, is any account taken of the quality of the background of the students?
Yes.
Taking those tests.
Yes. So into the, sorry, we're getting into the weeds here a little bit, but in the test score portion of your overall score, it's an actual value added estimation model, which does account for the demographics of the students.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
For these observations, do they do multiple observations at different time points in order to ensure that they don't have just one observation? If a teacher observed one day, maybe on one of those days where it has a pretty hard day,
yeah.
If they observe another time, maybe it may be seen as more effective on that day.
Do they, yes.
Like average, do they have multiple observations? Like, do you know how many? And if it's like distributed across the school year?
It is. Those are a great question. So the question was, how many observations, how are they distributed across the years, trying to sort of like give teachers chances to demonstrate their best performance rather than just coming in once. There are 5 observations a year, typically. They are spaced out across the year. And I think the other thing in this time period is like, if you have one observation that you just bombed, that like statistically is so different from all the other ones, you get to drop that score. So there are like several things set up in there to try to be like, it's not really like a trying to, we're not trying to catch you doing a bad job. Yeah. All right. Let me talk about the actual statistical side of this. So we've got our policy change in 2012-13, where those financial incentives really change. And I would say it's that there's a big incentive. The biggest incentive is to be in those low-performing, low-income schools. There's not much incentive left, financial at least, to stay in a high-income school. So we're going to do a difference in differences estimation strategy where we're looking at the pre and post-reform change in teachers' retention and mobility outcomes for quote-unquote treated teachers versus comparison group teachers. There is unfortunately not some super clean way to identify teachers who were affected by the change in policy versus teachers who were not affected. Our treated teachers are these highly effective teachers. Those are the teachers who were eligible for those financial incentives. So that seems pretty clear. The harder part here is trying to identify a group of teachers who are comparable to highly effective teachers, but who were not affected by the change in policies. And our best option here are the effective teachers. So these are teachers who don't get bonuses. They're not really eligible for salary increases. They also are not subject to any sanctions. They're not going to be dismissed. Their salary is not being held. It's sort of business as usual for them. We do have one small issue, which is that a subset of these affected teachers are actually eligible for a small salary increase, which I can get into those weeds with you later. But our rationale here was that by including these teachers in our comparison group, if anything, our effects would be attenuated because some of your comparison group teachers might be deciding to stay in a school to get this small salary increase. So if anything, they may also be increasing their retention in order to receive the salary increases. Is that okay? All right. We're going to estimate these models within a 7-year teacher level panel that has really detailed information about teachers' performance, their demographics, their experience, their race, gender, pretty much a lot of the things you could want to know about the teachers. We also know what school they're assigned to in each year, and that's how we're going to create our outcome variables. Whether you are staying at a low poverty school, whether you are moving to whether you're staying at a high income school or a low income school, or whether you're moving or leaving the district entirely. So that's all based on their school assignment. We also have school level districtors that helps us identify whether it's a low income school, high income school. And we also know about the students in those schools a bit. So the enrollment, the racial demographics, the usual things. We are going to estimate two different models. One that I'm going to call a simple differences model, where we're looking at the post-reform change for effective teachers relative to highly effective teachers. That's beta 3. And we're controlling for teacher covariates, things like their experience, whether they're in a tested grade or subject, other types of observable things that we think might be related to their decisions to stay or leave. And we are also controlling for student covariates. That's the Z here, so things like the performance of students, the size of the school, whether it's an elementary school or a middle school. And the second type of model we'll run is an annual difference in differences model. So same set of covariates in here. The only thing we're doing now is we're allowing the effect to vary in each post-reform year. So we're going to say, compared to the average retention of effective teachers and highly effective teachers before those financial incentives were changed, how do their retention outcomes change for each year in the post-period? I'm going to present the set of results in,
When did, so you're classifying people based on their effective, highly effective status, at what time period?
In that same year. So that's a good question. They get their rating at the end of a school year. A teacher is told you were effective, you were highly effective. And they also get told at that time, like, this is the bonus that you're eligible for.
Yes, sorry, the treated and comparison groups. How do you put them into the treated and comparison group? Well, at one point, or it changes over?
It changes. I see your question, yes. So they are allowed to move in and out of those treatment groups based on whatever their rating is each year.
Okay. And when did the district announce that the bonuses were changing?
They announced it in the summer of 2012, so before the beginning of the 2012-13 school year. Yeah, thanks. Kylie.
Did you say that was your first year of data?
Our first post year. Sorry, these are good questions. Our first year of data is here, 2010. The reforms get announced. If I could draw like an imaginary line here, it's before the 2012-13 school year. So these are my post-reform years, 2012-13, 13-14, 14-15, 15-16. Yeah.
Do they switch to the PARC assessment?
They do. Yeah, they switched to PARC right here in 2014-15. So that's a change in the student assessment. Thank you. which is not really going to, I mean,
it's for everyone.
Yes, it affects everybody. We can talk more about if we think that's problematic. Okay, so I'm going to start by showing you descriptively what the retention of highly effective and effective teachers looks like in low-income schools. And I'm gonna like orient you once because all of the diagrams are going to look similar to this. You've got your percent who are retained, the solid line are the effective teachers, so that's my comparison group. The dashed line are the highly effective teachers, so these are my teachers who start to become eligible for the larger bonuses and salary pay increases. Here's my line right between 2012 and 2013 of when those performance incentives changed. One thing to note here is that the retention rate is already pretty high. We're already talking about like 85 to 90% of teachers being retained. So it's not like we're starting from some super low point, but I think it's so worth investigating. Did these change in financial incentives change the decisions specifically of these highly effective teachers above and beyond the change we observe for the effective teachers, our comparison group? And I'm going to do something sort of unconventional here. I'm going to put my estimates from the diff and diff right into the picture because I don't like looking at a big table. So these are regression adjusted estimates. It's showing you the change in each post-reform year for effective teachers. And here's the change in retention of highly effective teachers in each post-reform year. Those are regression adjusted. So they might like visually may not map on perfectly to the descriptive picture. But the point here is that in almost every single post-reform year, highly effective teachers were more likely to stay at low-income schools relative to the change we observed for effective teachers, which is basically nothing. It's a zero.
When you say teacher retention, it's retention at the particular school they're at. Some of those teachers would have left the district, some were going to other schools in the district.
It's defined, actually, here specifically, it's defined as staying at a low-income school.
At any
low-income school. Essentially, though, whether you stay at the same school or stay at a low-income school is kind of the same thing. I forget the exact number. It's a very small number of people moving from one low-income school to another low-income school. But as far as how I defined it, I did define it as staying at any low-income school in the district.
Is there an increase in just the number of highly effective teachers who are incentivized to switch over? Because this is just people who were there before and stay the next year. So in that summer of 2012, can I say like, oh, I can get a ton of money next year if I move to
a lower from my the lower performing schools?
Is there like an absolute increase in the number of high performing teachers?
No, I don't think like as far. No, it's sort of like that, like 30. I forget what it was, 36% who were highly effective is pretty consistent across the years. But it is, I mean, you are reminding me that one sort of nitty gritty detail that I forgot to mention here is that in order to get those financial incentives, you do have to say you're coming back to a high poverty school. So that's part of what your question reminded me of. Like you have to give a very clear signal of like, I was highly effective in a low income school and I'm going to return to a low income school. If you don't say that and actually go back, you don't get those financial incentives. Okay. So these are the results for the annual diff and diff. As far as like the overall or simple diff and diff, we again are just seeing that there was basically no change in the retention of effective teachers, that's this coefficient, whereas highly effective teachers were about 5 percentage points more likely to stay at low-income schools. This is the big finding in this paper. Now I'm going to show you a bunch of null results, unfortunately.
But I think this is a clarifying question. So when you say low-income year, is that synonymous with targeted 40 or?
It's not.
Okay.
So there's like my three buckets of schools, and targeted 40 schools are low income, but I'm estimating their results completely separate. This is just for low income, non-targeted 40 schools. It's just for that like middle band of schools. So that is a clarifying question. Thank you.
This is what the retention looks like for, again, highly effective and effective teachers in our 40 low-performing schools. So descriptively, we see it's a bit lower. It's more like 75 to 85%, maybe. And no, not as clear of a trend line as we saw in the low-income schools. When I layer on the regression estimates, it's just like a whole lot of nothing. There are the point estimates are not meaningful, and there is nothing significant either. So in essence, the effective and highly effective teachers were no more likely to stay at these targeted 40 schools after those financial incentives were changed. And no surprise, in the simple diff and diff, we also see nothing significant as far as the change in their retention at low-performing low-income schools.
And then just ask a question, I think that combines what Eric asked earlier and what Gabby asked. So somebody seeing the change in the incentives, who was, say, at a high-income school, and who was affected, but thinks, I could be highly effective, but I'm going to move to a targeted 40 school or a non-targeted low-income school, could make that move, and they would get picked up in your data, if I understand correctly, in subsequent years if they became highly effective and then stayed. Is that right?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, they would be picked up if they became highly effective. Even if, I mean, they would only...
But they'd become part of the retention of the treated.
Yes.
If they stayed after they became highly effective.
Yes, correct.
So this is picking up people who are responding by transferring into this treatment group.
Mm-hmm.
Who then ultimately become successful and remain.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Emily. My scribe over here. All right. So then we have our high-income schools. These often got your beginning retention upwards of 85, 90%. And the sort of interesting, what seems to be descriptively, a downward trend. So meaning that fewer highly effective and effective teachers are staying in these high-income schools after their bonuses were taken away. That's basically what happened in these schools. The empirical estimates suggest that there's not actually much significant happening here, except for maybe this reduction in the retention of effective teachers in 2015. That is significant, but there's certainly nothing differentially happening for highly effective teachers versus effective teachers. And I think really what we have to be focusing on here is a difference in the behavior of the highly effective teachers. Those are the teachers who really were most impacted by the loss in financial incentives versus these effective teachers. Yeah.
Yeah. When teachers leave DC public schools, what do they typically do? Do they go teach in a surrounding area or move out of the DC area altogether?
I
kind of understand this pattern.
Yeah.
You've made it less attractive to be at the high income schools, mm-hmm. so they just go teach in Arlington or Montgomery.
Yeah, I mean, and what I can show you is that, at least in this data, most of these teachers are leaving DCPS altogether. I don't know where they are going, specifically. I don't know if they're going
DC
to...
DC public schools.
Correct. They're leaving the public schools. They could be going to a charter school, which is not a part of this data here. They could be going to Montgomery County, or any of those surrounding counties. But we have some survey data of where teachers indicate what they're doing. It's not a part of this analysis, but teachers do sometimes, they take a declaration of intent not to return survey and they say, I am leaving for family reasons, or I'm leaving for to go back to school. I don't know off the top of my head what are those like top rank reasons for leaving DCPS.
Yeah. You said a moment ago, bonuses taken away. Yeah. Is it the case that if I was highly effective in 11 and 12 and therefore achieved my two consecutive and got my vote, does that get taken away from
me? No, it doesn't get taken away. Sorry. That's a very poor language. It's just that you can't get it anymore.
But your bonus, I mean, the difference between
the
base pay,
bonuses.
But the bonus was a meaningful difference.
Yeah, so you're still
taken away.
Yeah, essentially gets taken away, right? It's like there's like a token amount. If you're highly effective, you get $3,000. You used to get $12,500. Yeah.
I'm still a little puzzled. Are you losing money or did your salary actually go down?
No. No, it does not get taken away from you. It's just that if you are twice highly effective in this period here, if you were twice highly effective at a high income school, you were eligible for that permanent salary increase.
Okay.
In this post-reform period, if you continue to be twice highly effective, they are no longer offering you that salary increase.
So it's the opposite.
So suppose you were
ran highly effective under the old system. Would you have got, I mean, where can you get another $27,000 a year increase?
If you go to a targeted 40 school, yes. If you decide to.
On top of that, you go from $75,000 to $100,000.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, exactly. They're big incentives. But you have to be in a targeted 40 school.
Yeah.
And just to clarify, further with, if you were in the low-income schools, your opportunity was the same regardless of the policy change, right? So, you had access to it before, that, extra $25,000, for instance, and then afterwards, you still had access to the $25,000.
In these schools?
In
low-income?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's, sorry. This clearly need a better way of presenting these changes. In the low income but not targeted 40 schools, your bonus is decreased a bit.
Okay.
Your maximum bonus amount is now $15,000 instead of $25,000. It's only in the targeted 40 schools that you can continue to earn that maximum bonus and the maximum permanent salary increase.
And what was the kind that you showed us before the high income? Was it the targeted 40 or was it just low income that you didn't see a change in?
Where we didn't see a change was in those targeted 40 schools.
Because I guess that kind of makes sense with your. Nothing really changed for you?
Nothing really changed. Yeah, it's more like there is this change in the maximum salary increase, but it's true. I mean, fair point. Like, your bonus amount is not changing. But if you, I don't know if teachers think of it this way, if they're thinking relative to what I could earn in a different school, it's like, it's potentially worth staying in that targeted 40 school. I think that's at least DCPS's hope.
Yeah.
That.
So if I'm understanding the results, right? It seems like then a lot of the action is coming from that middle group, right? The low income, not low performing group.
Correct.
And so could you tell us a little bit more about those schools? Like, are they still lower performing than the high income schools?
Yeah. They are.
Yeah.
I mean, and I think that was some of the descriptive stuff that I showed in the beginning, right? It's like, it's very much like a middle group. These low-income schools are lower performing than the high-income schools. They are also higher performing than the targeted 40 schools. But these are schools where, I mean, the designation to be a low-income school is something like 60% of students are eligible for free and reduced price lunch.
And so the benefits actually went down in those schools.
Yeah.
But the retention.
Yeah, the bonus goes down, the salary increase does increase.
Okay.
So there's sort of two things happening simultaneously. Julie, and then
I'll let you get through this, but I think my puzzle is what Jim asked a while ago about sorting.
Yeah.
And the ways in which the teachers who sort into these schools to begin with look similar to or different from each other.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think then is also related to what Walter was asking about, thinking about distribution and whether or not these ratings mean the same thing in different places.
Yeah.
That's not really a clarifying question, I'm sorry.
No, I mean, and maybe it's something we can come back to. I mean, I think as far as if I'm just thinking about the estimation of it, I feel like it's a great and important question, but I think the results still hold, but it's important in terms of thinking about how do I frame those results or really think about what it means in the bigger picture.
Well, and the implications for other districts who might want to have policies like this and the ways in which they might work differently.
Yeah.
Based on the composition of teachers in the school.
Yeah. Yeah. Like if you are the only highly effective teacher in your school, or, I mean, that's a very extreme example, but.
And we can talk about this more later, but when I think about the highly effective teachers in the high income schools, those are just different people who might have different prospects. Yeah. So like in thinking about the idea of like prospects, like the financial prospect in DCPS might feel different relative to like their financial prospect elsewhere than if they sorted into a different school.
I don't think I understand the second half of your.
Like people who go to work in targeted 40 schools on average might have fewer prospects, and that's why they're there in the first place.
Maybe.
I don't know how to look at it empirically, but I think that's
people, yes. But I mean, I think like those highly effective teachers are, they, I would like to think, maybe not that I feel like those effective and highly effective teachers, regardless of where they are, have better prospects because they're great, they're good teachers. So they can possibly take those skills out of the teaching labor market entirely is one option.
Yeah. It might be worth looking at like the degree to which you have pathways, like information or the background characteristics of teachers. I know it's like complicated,
yeah,
but just thinking about like tell a story about who these people,
yeah,
are and why they might be moving.
Gotcha. One more question. Yeah.
What does teacher effectiveness ratings look like from year to year within the same teacher? Like,
how much are teachers moving across categories? A good thing to look into. I would not know off the top of my head. I mean, people move around. But it's usually like between like parallel bands. You know, you're not moving from like highly effective to minimally effective. So it's. Yeah.
And like if you see trajectories up or if you see people going up that.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. All right. I've got 15 minutes. I'm sorry. I went into the weeds with you guys. So. Okay. So I think I was about here where we see in the high income schools. So these are the places where there's basically no more financial incentive to stay in these high income schools. Effective teachers were a little less likely to stay. There's no difference for the highly effective teachers in the post-reform period. But I want to come back to this sort of like downward trend that we see here, because these highly effective teachers at low-income schools, as I see it, and I think you guys see it too, it's like they have some options about what they could do. They could leave, or they can move to some of those other schools. If they think they are going to continue to be highly effective, the incentives are set up to say, like, why don't you come try to teach at a low-income or low-performing low-income school? So here I was just coming back to these incentives. I think we've looked at them enough. But here I'm just showing you the share of highly effective teachers who are leaving DCPS. That's the light blue line. Versus the very, very small portion of these highly effective teachers who maybe move to a targeted 40 school. That's this sort of beige line. And who moved to a low income but not targeted 40 school. That's this blue line down here. So this type of movement is very uncommon. And in a way that's not hugely surprising, because I think like if you know the teacher transfer initiative with these big incentives to move to a low performing school, and basically like it was super hard to get teachers to take them up. And that's sort of what we are observing here as well, unfortunately. In terms of the actual difference in differences estimate, there's a lot of nothing again. Here is the change for effective teachers versus highly effective teachers. And again, we would hope to see something different in the dashed line or in those sort of gold estimates versus the changes among effective teachers. And nothing's really happening. These are the people who are leaving the high income schools. And I'm going to change the y-axis dramatically. It only goes up to 5% here. But these are the movements from a high-income to a low-income school. Again, no significant changes. You could count on one hand, maybe on two hands, the number of teachers who make this movement. It is very, very uncommon for teachers to move from, for a highly effective or an effective teacher to move from a high-income school to a low-income school, despite the change in financial incentives. And the same is true for moving from a high-income school to one of those targeted 40 schools. It just, here is the line for highly effective teachers who are making this movement. And it's just like, it's not even getting up above 1%. We're talking about a handful of teachers who make that movement, which is not enough to say that like, people are moving to the targeted 40 schools to get incentives. Okay, so to summarize, I think the big finding from this analysis, I think, is that the performance-based financial incentives do seem to have encouraged high-performing teachers to stay in those low-income schools, that sort of middle band, but it doesn't do much for the low-performing, low-income schools. So the ones that I started by arguing were the ones that really need the teachers the most. Low-income schools need good teachers too, but it's like if we had to place these schools into tiers, I would think that it's those targeted 40 schools that are really, really desperately in need of more highly effective teachers. I think the other thing that we are seeing is that removing these financial incentives, and I need to be careful about my language here because I think I'm confusing people and making you think that bonuses are being taken away, which is not the case. It's just that the removal of the opportunity to earn a bonus doesn't actually change the employment decisions of those high-performing teachers in high-income schools. So those two findings together sort of leave me feeling like financial incentives might help improve the teacher quality in low-income schools, but that something else, or maybe a lot of something else, needs to happen in those really lowest performing schools. I don't know what that something else is. I think it's seemingly not about money, is what these results would seem to suggest. It may have to do with working conditions, school climate, the people you work with, any number of things. I think the other piece that's coming out from this work for me is that really coming back to this importance of professional development. So if you think back to that distribution that I shared in the beginning, we are talking, in this paper, we're talking about changing retention rates from like 80% to 85%, or 85% to 95%. It's a margin, it's an important margin, but I think if we really wanted to think about helping all teachers improve, not just that upper end of the distribution, that's where it becomes really important to understand more about what do we do to help teachers improve their practice in a really meaningful way. I don't know the answer to that, but I think it's part of work that we are doing with DC right now, and hopefully that many of you are also doing, but that's where I sort of see some of this work going in the future. I think that's all that I have. Happy to answer more questions. I'm also here, so we can continue this conversation whenever you want. Thank you very much. Peter.
I've got a couple questions. I enjoyed your talk. They both have to do with sort of how you're categorizing the schools in this sample. So if you could tell us just a little bit about like what qualifies to be high income versus low income. You'd be anywhere for high income for 1% eligible for free reduced lunch up to 29%, and then for high poverty, could you be anywhere from like 30% to 99%?
Gotcha. So again, I think I just want to make clear that it's not, these are like not our designations. These are DCPS's designations of like, you are a low income school, you are a high income school. The cutoff point technically for low income versus high income depended on the percent of students who were eligible for free and reduced price lunch. And if 60% or more of your students were eligible for free and reduced price lunch, you were considered a low-income school. It gets a little tricky because then they started to do a different way of accounting for free and reduced price lunch, but essentially, like, once you were designated a low-income school, that status stayed that way for several years. You don't really move in and out of being a low-income versus high-income school.
Okay, my next question is kind of related. But for the targeted 40, could that school change its status during the time of your analysis, or could it at some point change its status in the future?
So the future is now, because this targeted 40 designation no longer exists in DC, but for the period of our analysis, it stayed from 2012-13, which is when they first identified those schools throughout the rest of our panel. Those targeted 40 schools, the same 40 schools were targeted 40 schools. No other schools got added to sort of like that portfolio of schools. Yes. You were going to ask a question earlier.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I have like two. The first one is a bit more tangentially related to the opening in terms of, because I know that this is a question of like teacher retention, and you have these different categories in the evaluation tool, but I was wanting to know if the evaluation tool was necessarily the the only thing that was interacting with like teachers' understanding of their job assurance, or if there was still some sort of tenure function or policy that might be sitting situated outside of the evaluation system?
That's a really good question. Part of impact being able to exist is that tenure was essentially done away with. So especially if you accept, I'm going to not remember the exact details of this, but I believe that if you accept a bonus, you give something up. I don't want to say for sure that it's you give up the opportunity to be tenured, but it does have some consequence in terms of your retirement and like your ability to leave the district. I do not remember what it is, and I should look into that. The other thing is that part of the fact that DCPS was able to dismiss their low-performing teachers really stands against typical tenure agreements. And so that is because they were able to negotiate this different arrangement where it's like, if you are ineffective, you have to leave, which typically can't be done under tenure.
Okay. The other piece of my question, because I remember you showing like the general trend lines for high performing teachers in high income schools somewhat drifting down, and you said that I recall the graph that showed that there was an increase in the retention of high performing teachers in low income schools. But I'm wondering if there was an increase in any change in representation of high.
It's a mouthful. High performing teachers,
right, in the low income schools as opposed to the retention.
There is, and I can go back to that if it's helpful, because there is for sure.
I was trying to remember the table, so it was
picture better than a table, maybe. Here is the share of teachers who are highly effective by school poverty status. So there is, I mean, it's a pretty dramatic increase. In the beginning, you've got 10% of teachers. Sorry, I'll just let you take it in.
All right. So the reason I was asking about it is because now I'm not thinking sort of what happens next. I'm wondering I'm thinking about teacher selection, mm-hmm. and I'm wondering what is happening at the hiring point to help us identify the high performing teacher in the low performing school, in the low income school category, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, so that's not captured here, but that's
what I'm thinking. I want to like throw it to you. I think it's a great, it sort of is related to some questions that other people were asking about, like Julie's question about pathways, right? And selection and sorting, and like, how are these teachers ever ending up in these different schools? So noted, I think it's an important thing to try to unravel a bit more. Sorry, and then Dave, sorry.
I'm interested in your partnership with DC Public Schools and how they're either using this data or you might be suggesting that they use this information to inform their teacher policy.
I need to share an updated version of this work with them, because our panel ends 2016, so to them this is pretty dated. Like, they're already thinking about the current school year, the future school years. Like, this is, I don't think, to be frank, is really informing their decisions at this point. The partnership, which has been going on for 8 years now, something like that, there have been other ways to exchange information with them and results that have sort of helped. I think it has been helpful to them. I'd like to think it's been helpful to them in terms of when they've changed impact many, many times, and a lot of that has been driven by research, by information we've shared, information that they've done internally. So. Does that answer your question? A bit. One thing I know is that these incentives are expensive, and I think DCPS would like to figure out, like, can we reduce them? Can we get rid of them? And I don't know if my research really can inform that question.
Are they still using that incentive format?
Very nice study.
Thank you.
We should, there's always a tendency to say, boy, no results when you put, we can learn as much from lower results as we can from what researchers usually consider to be good results, which I got something statistically committed.
Right.
This, I mean, I think you said it earlier, this basically says we have less leverage with compensation than we thought we did.
Yeah.
And that means that teachers have a much more complex process of choosing schools and choosing where they teach. And for instance, I'm from this district, and I lived in Virginia for a long time. You know, when a teacher chooses a school, it's partly they have to be located someplace close to the school. So changing a school often means, you know, they have to relocate DC traffic. I mean, it's a big decision for them to go from one school possibly to another school. So that's part of it. Part of it also, the principals are still the gatekeepers, right? In terms of a teacher coming into your school. So they have to pass the principal test, which may or may not be a good test at all. But so it's a very complex decision for a teacher even to not only change districts, go out to Fairfax to teach, but even change the district. It could be a relocation, it could be a new principal, new school climate, the whole thing. And so I guess I'm not, after hearing the results, I'm not surprised that we didn't get a huge, more larger effect. But I think
especially on the transfer front, you know, right? Yeah.
And one of the next steps really is to do a survey of the teachers in districts. It begins to sort of shape out that what's their decision-making process in terms of which schools they teach in, where they're going to leave, and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But it's a great start.
Thank you.
Good, because building off that, I also agree that I think this is a really important empirical opportunity to think about, I'll just use, you know, Mike's book language, the trade-off between sort of monetary compensation and other forms of compensation. And so in that sense, it harkens back to like the stuff that Hanyshek Rivkin and Kane, K-A-I-N did years ago. And, you know, the sort of Mathematica experiments where they paid people to move to schools and they stayed, and then when they stopped paying them, they moved back. So, but you have, I think, more variation than any of those papers did. You know, for any person at any given year, what the potential incentive from the program is, right? So
right.
Some people have already been highly educated and highly experienced, and even if they're highly effective 2 years in a row, it's not gonna increase their salary that much because they're already sort of topped out. And then you have this sort of nice, relatively unexpected change in that function, but you observe that function in the pre-period too. So you could, you know, at the complex end of things, you could do sort of a within teacher change over time in how they respond to their own individual monetary incentives. And there's going to be a group of teachers who are highly effective, who are always going to be highly effective. And what's going to be changing for them is the potential incentives. But I would also say, I think you also need to do this, go the other direction too, and do something simple, because right now you're allowing the change in policy to affect whether you're in the treatment or comparison group. And that's unconventional and hard to think about. So you could start with something very simple, which is just, you know, divide teachers into groups where like one group is teachers who have already achieved their 2 years in a row highly effective.
But you can do it again. You can, if you're tired.
Yeah.
Sorry, go ahead.
We can talk more about it, but I think you need to define people based on pre-policy change conditions.
Okay.
Follow them over time as the sort of standard
starting
point.
Okay.
For a sort of dip and dip.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Brian, we're going this way, Brian, Rebecca.
Yeah, so I guess kind of tagging on to some of the discussion about like why we aren't seeing changes in the spectrum of monetary incentives. I think one story is like that the preferences of teachers are much more complicated than we expect, and that like there are other factors besides money. But I'm also wondering if it's just a story of like the money's not actually that certain, I would imagine, for a teacher in a position, a high income school, highly effective. Like to speak to some of the ideas we were about earlier, like if I imagine being a teacher who's highly effective in the school that I'm at, both the frictional costs of me going to another school are probably incredibly high, but also that like if I am a teacher who's collaborative, who's working, who's learning a lot, I would probably expect that at least some proportion of my effectiveness is due to colleagues that I work with, due to my competency in the current curriculum material that I work with, to knowing some of the students that I currently have in the classroom. And so I'm wondering, like, yeah, if some of this is just like an expected value problem, but like the expected value of me switching as a highly effective teacher from this school to that school ends up almost nulling out because I'm so uncertain about how likely I am to be highly effective
in that
kind of move.
Yeah.
And so I'm about the temporary costs. Yeah, and then add to that all the other costs, all the other frictional pieces. So I'm wondering too if there's like, right, like as a teacher back in the classroom, I remember like the folklore was always like, yeah, you move a school, you're always terrible. Like you're always like bad for a year or two. I'm wondering if there's any way you can at least empirically start to look at like, are some of the uncertainties that might be associated with a teacher moving schools at all validated?
Right.
Like perhaps factoring in, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so like, for instance, like if you were highly effective for these handful of teachers who do move, what happens when they move and what happens to their performance in the following years after they've moved?
Yeah, exactly. And like whether or not they move to any particular type of like school, even like just conditional on having left the school that you were just in, what happens to your effectiveness?
Yeah. Thank you. That is a great question.
Do you have any information about the difference in financial investment of DCPS, like prior to this policy versus after it? Because, you know, prior you're incentivizing, you know, regularly increasing all highly effective teachers, whereas if after the policy change, you're only focusing on the, you know, the low income, but also probably have more financial investment for those teachers as opposed to prior. So do you know anything about kind of how much money they were giving to this prior to the policy versus after it, just in thinking about like applicability to other districts that may not be able to make this change?
I definitely don't know off the top of my head. I mean, so it seems like part of what you're getting at is like, how are they funding this very expensive program?
And it's more expensive to only to pay more for low income schools than to everybody at high.
Yeah. And it's something we could look at, like how much money did they spend on bonuses and salary increases every year. I mean, it was able to get off of the ground because of outside funding. So it's not like this is not money that DCPS had at the ready. There were several big grants that made it possible. And I don't know if that sort of factors into their position now of like, can we reduce these or get rid of them? I assume it does, you know, resources are limited. But it's, I don't know it, I think it is knowable. Walter.
So Brian's comment actually made me think, it sounds like another margin of this that DCPS seems to think about is like teachers that are already at the targeted 40 schools now have a massive incentive to be essential to become highly effective. I don't know how fungible that is. Is that something that you or others have looked at? Like is this incentive
helping people move into that bracket?
Like, oh man, like I now have this math, like I'm already out of school, you know, these intangible costs are null for me, and I now have a massive incentive to try to, I don't know how easy, like how sort of, maybe this is Dolores' question, like how easy it is to move from one room to another, but it feels like that's like $25,000 is a lot of money.
Yeah, right, and especially like the people right on the margins,
right?
And so I think like that's where like, the regression discontinuity work makes sense, and it is, you know, people, based on that incentive, people do what they need to do to improve.
Have we written that paper already? No. Did you write that paper already?
That one. Oh, that one. Yes. Yes. So, but I mean, but I think you're asking something different, because it's, I'm part of the reason I still think this work is important is because I didn't want to focus just on the people at the margin. I think regression discontinuity is great, but I wanted to be able to talk about, like, we're talking about the top half of the teacher distribution here. This is a much bigger population of teachers.
that are potentially being affected by the incentives. But like, yes, people try to move into the highly effective without manipulation, without like undoing regression discontinuity. The incentive does encourage people to improve their performance. Laura.
I'm just curious a little bit about the observation more. So that's about 75% of like non-tested teachers impact score. And were you saying that it's a mix of observers but includes third party observers? It's not just like how big a component is a local observer, such as a principal or something?
Principal.
Could you get any traction off of principal switches? Like, is there anything there?
It doesn't happen very much. We a lot of people have tried to use the principal switching for something great, and it just doesn't happen, unfortunately. But does that answer your other question about
that? Yeah, kind of, but also, how is it a big component? Are they trying to make sure that those are connected together? Because you could also imagine some kind of gaming happening with principals, and then teachers up, you know, a nice principal.
Yeah, and it's like the system is not immune to that. So let's see here, somewhere way down here, there's a better way to do this. Sorry. There we go. Here are the components for group one are the teachers who have student achievement data. So 35% of their score is their value added. 15% is their like goals I set for my students. 40% is their observation score. So TLF, the teaching and learning framework, is the framework that's being used by observers. And then the remaining 10% is something called a commitment to school community. And then there's this other like little magic finger on the scale issue that's not here, which is called core professionalism, which only works to your detriment. So if you're doing good, it's a zero, but you get reduction. I believe is the way it works. So like if a principal is like, you were late all the time, you were not professional, it's a minus 10 points off of your score. So that's sort of how the score is coming together for group one. This is what it looks like for teachers who don't have student achievement data. So as I was saying, 75% of your overall score are those observations. There are 5 observations typically. 3 of them, you use a much better word for it, third party. Thank you for that terminology. 3 of those are from a third party and 2 are from your principal. I believe they're equally weighted, unless you want to drop one that was very bombed. Ariel.
So I don't know if you said this already, but I'm just thinking about the school that I worked in that had differential pay for levels, and it was the money was provided by the district, but it was budgeted at the school level, so it ended up like eating more of the school's budget if they had more effective teachers. And so there was this weird story about like, am I strategically sort of deciding how many teachers are going to be effective or not? And I just don't know if you know anything about how that's like dealt with in DC and whether it affects the school's budget.
That seems like one of those situations where it's like unintended consequences. It's not budgeted at the school level, so okay. It's sort of like, we have this pot of money across the district. There's no like quotas within a school or anything like that of like, you can only afford to pay this many incentives. Right.
I feel like the answer is probably yes, but I just want to make sure. Like in order for someone to move from a high performing school or a low performing school to the top 40, there needs to be like some sort of appropriate vacancy.
Yeah.
I imagine that there's like no shortage of those vacancies.
Right, yeah, I mean, I shouldn't say that so quickly. I haven't looked at that, but those are the schools where you have way more turnover than those targeted for the schools.
Talk about the observations. You said two principal ratings. Are all the principals given the same assessment sheet to work off of? And also, are the principals trained in terms of evaluating? Because if the principal who has just became a principal for their first year, it may not be as good in terms of evaluating as someone who has been a principal for a longer period of time.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, was that taken into account where they could be trained on how to use the assessment and how to go about grading?
Yeah. So it is a standardized protocol for every, it's the same one for their third-party observers, what they call their master educators, and for principals. Everybody's using the same set of same rubric, same set of standards, and same sort of like protocol, as you would call it, I think. There is some effort to train people. I don't know how robust that was. You know, I think like in sort of what seems to be now to be a sort of typical DC fashion, it's like this went from nothing to fully implemented in no time. You know, it was like fall 2009, we are doing this in every single school, period. And there wasn't, I guess there was like a little bit of piloting of some things, but for the most part, it was like, get up to speed, guys. So I think principals got some training, and there's ongoing training throughout the existence of IMPACT to sort of continue to get people to, some of it's online, some of it was in person. So there is an effort to get people to be reliable. Kylie.
Yeah, so I know that there's been a lot of widespread changes in thinking about IMPACT family, and I'm just wondering if any of those are targeted at school leaders, like the principals themselves, or?
Yes. It's not something I know as much about, but like there is an impact for school leaders, for instance. They also get evaluated. I don't think you see as much variation in their performance. I think like they got evaluated and everybody's effective or highly effective, and it's not as consequential as impact. And then there have been partnerships with outside providers to give support to principals as well. So there are for sure efforts being made to improve the quality of leadership in DC as well. Preston.
I have two quick questions. One is kind of about the location of the city of schools where you have kind of high performance or high income schools and maybe some like lower income schools somewhat closer than other lower income schools. I wonder if there's any implications for using some mapping data. Like just kind of thinking like if you're a professional, you know, kind of nicely entrenched in your career, you kind of have a routine, perhaps this financial incentive may seem more meaningful to you if it's to go to a school that's just a few miles away. If you live in Northwest, for instance, relative to traveling 40 minutes along, you know, 395 in the morning, if you get all the way down the southeast. I'm just curious, you know, if some schools in certain parts of the city are more successful in attracting some low-income schools are more successful in attracting highly effective teachers than others, perhaps just by virtue of proximity to the higher-income schools where the teachers are leaving.
I don't have any insight on that. I mean, I think at a quick glance, when I saw that it was so few people moving, I was like, well, does anything jump out to us? Like, is it like a massive group of people moving from here to there? And it's like one person moving from here to there. So there didn't seem to be, like, at a quick glance, a very clear trend in terms of, like, this one low-income school really seems to be attracting people. Like, what's going on there? Like, to your point, is it close to a high-income school? I mean, I think this idea of, like, commute time or something is interesting. I feel like it would be possibly best done if you knew where the teachers were starting from, as opposed, because, like, we can look at where schools are located. I don't know where teachers are beginning their commute. But I mean, it's a good point. It's like if the schools are close together, it's the same commute to get to two very different types of schools. They are, I know, like schools are pretty clustered, like no surprise, right? A lot of the high income schools are in Northwest DC. A lot of the targeted 40 schools are across the river.
Closer you get to those like quad
boundaries.
Yeah. But and then the other one's kind of just a history question. We were talking in the back of just like how both of those all three groupings of effectiveness trends kind of like sloped sharply upward between 11 and 13.
Right.
Is that just adaptation? Is that like a big change in who's teaching?
The fact that more teachers are being rated highly effective.
Yeah, it looked like a 100% increase on this.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, it could be just inflation. It could just be, could be a lot of things. And I don't know why it happens. Even if you look at, like, the full distribution of people's impact scores, like, those distributions do sort of, like, shift over time to the right. So it could be people actually getting better, maybe, if we're being optimistic. It could be.
After 13, right? Like from 11 to 13, it looks sharpest.
Yeah. Could be a lot, like,
yeah,
it's a lot of things, right? It could also be the impact is getting reformed a lot in the beginning period. They're sort of they're fine-tuning it a lot in the beginning. No.
I think you got it. There it is.
Nope.
No, that's not it either.
Sorry, they look all the same. This.
There it is. Yep.
So then it sort of seems to stabilize.
Right.
Especially in those high-income schools. Right. Yeah, I don't know.
And I guess, yeah, and then the bottom two will continue to respond.
Yeah.
Anyways, sorry. Thank you.
It's an important clarifying question. So this whole concept of the bonuses and salary increases, though, started in 2010, and then they just changed?
Yes.
So could that just be sort of the effect of the bonuses and incentives existing?
This
upward trend?
Yeah.
And then the shift is, I don't know, that's just trying to make sense.
Essentially, I want to make sure I'm following what you're saying. Like, essentially, like, hey, we know this bonus is coming. Let's start teaching better.
So the bonuses and salary increases started in 2010, but then they changed the nature of them in 2012 and 2013, so that it was targeted toward the low income and low performing schools, right? So like before, everybody had the same incentives, regardless of what type of school, like the same.
More similar
bonus and salary increases starting in 2010. And so that maybe incentivized everybody to sort of go after those, but then the shift didn't seem to it's interesting then to think of, like, the shift didn't then cause that to, I don't know.
Well, I think it's also like, I'm thinking of Arielle and Rebecca's comments too, where it's like, it's hard to put myself in the position of DCPS here with, like, we are implementing this program. We have no idea how many people are going to be eligible for bonuses. And then it was like, okay, that's how many bonuses we're giving. And so I don't know if there was sort of some fine tuning of sort of being like, if we really think about what a highly effective teacher is, can we really say that 30%, 33%, 40% of our teachers are highly effective? And so that's, I sort of think, what prompts some of their fine tuning. You know, it's like trying to refine the way that they were putting people into those buckets a little bit. Jim.
Veronica, you alluded to this, but I think it's relevant. Could you talk a little bit, I mean, as you, impact is not just a financial incentive, right? And
right.
So I think the skepticism around, well, now we're telling teachers they have access to this money, and oh, look, they got better. Mm-hmm. You might just talk for a minute about the other aspects of impact that might account for some of that increase.
Yeah, I mean, for sure. I think impact itself was, like, seen as a support system, too. It's like, if we think about the widget effect, right? So we're going back 10 years now, but this is this big descriptive report that was like teachers saying, like, I don't feel valued. I don't feel like people know how good my performance is. And this is sort of in response to that in some ways. And it's saying like, okay, we are going to observe you frequently and tell you exactly how you're doing. And there are really strict guidelines around like how quickly principals and master educators have to give you the feedback from your observation. So it was like, here, like, you teachers have said they want to know how they're doing, we will tell you how you're doing. And it's been thought that might help them improve, because it's being given a much clearer signal of, like, you're doing great on fielding questions, you need to do a better job on, like, promoting higher level thinking, and here are ways to do that. So it is a little bit more of the hand-holding. Yeah, it's a great point. It's not just about, like, good job, you're highly effective, here's a bonus. There's much more support built into it. And so that, I think, to Jim's point, that is also possibly, hopefully, helping teachers get better and shifting the distribution of teacher effectiveness.
In mind with that, there's got to be an organizational, once the incentives are known to come forward, it depends on two things. One is that the teachers trust their evaluations. They have, I know what I have to do, got to be a lot of randomness about that process. And I wonder what the teachers, if you would ask the teachers, do they trust the fact that I was rated effective and this teacher was not effective? What's the difference? But for them, it's can I be effective? How can I be effective? And that's sort of the environment you have around you to teach with, principals and all that. But also how much you trust the process of picking up the fact that you're a better teacher. When I saw that, my sense was the district wanted to have more teachers in the highly effective and effective lines because that's where the incentives are. So I don't know how they would, I don't know how they, whether the rating system changed for teachers in that period. That was my first guess here, is that in order for the incentives to work, you've got to have more teachers that are effective or highly effective. So I don't know, somehow we're going to do the ratings in a way that puts more teachers in that category. Is that the concern?
It does. I mean, the issue of trusting the system is well taken. I don't know how to measure that. I think the rating system has changed many times. There's been a lot of tweaking. But what's interesting to me is that if I think of like a key shift that DC made when they now have these five rating categories they created this developing category. When impact first existed, that was not there. Teachers were rated highly effective, effective, minimally effective, ineffective. And what they were seeing is that like so many people, maybe 50% of teachers were being rated quote unquote effective. And then I really liked that at least what they told us they did was that they realized, let's look at the rating of a new teacher, brand new first year teacher. The vast majority of them were being rated effective. And they were like, that's just not realistic. Like if we really think about a first year teacher, our rating, our scale is not reflecting true effectiveness and true high effectiveness. And so that's when they were like, we need to shift around these boundaries to make it a more accurate representation of what we think effective teaching looks like. It's not a first year teacher, by and large. Some first year teachers may be amazing, but the majority of them should not be getting their effective rating in that first year.
Great, thank you.
Thank you very much.